So, I took a car ride with a lady named Lisa Barnes to Boston, to Bunker Hill Community College, for the very first podcast where I acquired this shirt, which is now fraying at the neck and other areas. And we were at the first PodCamp, and it was a really cool, awesome experience. And I did want to make a point, which was that it was preceded by podcasts across borders, and I want to make that point, not just to kiss Bob's behind, but because that I feel like that was part of the whole, even though it's not formally a PodCamp per se, it's part of the kind of bigger community. And a lot of the people, you guys came down to Boston, and a lot of the same folks from PAB. And I do feel like that sort of Canadian nexus of people that met at PAB and were connected through that went down to Boston, and that kind of caused a lot of this in some way. So, you know, the first PodCamp was sort of the start of it, but I feel like Podcasters Across Borders was also part of that. So we went, we had fun. Jeff Pulver, who was the guy who co-founded Vonage, bought drinks for everyone. And that was messy but great. And that started the tradition of drinking a lot at PodCamp also, which is very important. And we came back and then the very specific moment, and I would say there's origin myths and stories, and I think something like this probably would have happened one way or another. But I know the moment that it started, which was when Lisa on her podcast interviewed a guy named Brian Person, who is one of the guys who doesn't get a lot of credit, and there was a whole team of people. So Chris Penn and Chris Brogan are the guys who get kind of a lot of credit for starting PodCamp, and rightly so. But they had a team too. They had a bunch of people, and one of them was a guy named Brian Person, great guy, a podcaster, a guy that I've worked with a little bit, and he was being interviewed by Lisa on Lisa's podcast. And Lisa, the exchange went something like this. Lisa said something like, "Brian, we had a great time at PodCamp. Are you guys going to do that again in Boston?" And he goes, "Why don't you guys do it in Toronto?" And she went, "Ding." And she sent out an email, and that went to a group of us Toronto podcast people and said, "Hey, we should do this." And a few people responded. So Brian was not here. I thought he was going to be here. But Brian responded, I responded, and a few other people responded to say, "That sounds like fun." So then we had to find a place. And this is the one thing I will take full credit for, which was I said, why don't we do it at my alma mater, at Ryerson? And why don't we do it at the Roger Kincaid Center, where I went to school? Because I know all the people there, and it's a cool room, and they'll like that. And so I called my friend Brad Portner, who was that time the manager of the facility here, and said, "Brad, we want to do this thing." He's like, "Right on. Bring it on. Come on up." So that's how it started. And we said, how about, it's Toronto, why not February? Because I just called you out, you weren't here.
I'm sorry.
He pointed out to me earlier, he was the first person to respond to this email, and I was the second. So he's as responsible, if not more so.
Yeah, but
his message
said first.
I'm that guy. I'm sure it did. And that's how it began. And it was the original, I guess, organizing committee was you, me, Lisa, Mitch and Julian?
Yes.
And was that everybody?
Yeah, I think so.
So, yeah, and so Mitch, Joel, and Julian, who were actually from Montreal, pitched in. And they did more from afar, but when they got here, they actually pitched in a lot. Julian put a lot of stuff in his credit card. that was actually Julian's big contribution. It took him years to get some of that money back, I think.
We did finally pay him back, though.
I know. And that's funny, right? Because when Rob came on, you had to figure out how we were going to pay him back eventually. You closed the loop on that. So that's how it began, and we had 300-ish people?
I feel like it was 400.
Was that many?
I think so.
Damn.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And as you did at a PodCamp, then we just started a wiki page, and people came on the wiki page and put their names on it. And we did that for a few years.
Yeah.
We'll talk more about the wiki probably later, right? So that's how it started. So and it looked very much like it looks now. It was, although not as nice signage, not as nice shirts. We didn't have most of that stuff. But really, the sessions, like, you could have walked, we could drop into one of those sessions now, and the big difference would be people would have laptops rather than smartphones, and everything else would look the same. So that was the start.
And you were doing this for, what, 3 years?
I was on the organizing committee, and I was kind of, I feel like Lisa was sort of the lead in the first year, but I was sort of co-lead in a way, and then I was sort of lead-ish guy, mainly because of the Ryerson relationship, for the first 3 years. And then I got angry, but we can talk more about that later.
Just don't get him angry.
Don't get me angry. Wouldn't like me when I'm angry. Yeah, that's what started.
And then you stepped in.
Well, yeah, I had a nominal role in that first year in the sense that I think it was me and duct tape guy, Sean Magahi, and I decided that they don't have a blog. How can these guys not have any social media for this PodCamp?
So, we forgot about that.
So we said, well, we can do this. We can pitch it. So the two of us took on the blogging, and that was kind of fun. I don't even remember what we blogged about. I think we blogged about, like, don't forget your business card or something. like things to do when you got a PodCamp. I don't know. So that was sort of the nominal. And then after that, when the next year, it's like, well, are we going to keep this going? Stepped up and said, okay, let's help Jay and Eden as well, Spodek, and I think Rob.
I just saw her. She's just by the time.
Yeah.
Give her the evil eye, but she's not working.
And Rob, did you get involved that second year as well?
It was the second or the third
year.
I can't
remember. Yeah.
It's all over. I know. Yeah. I feel like second year was Yumi, Eden, Dave Flea.
Yeah.
And
it's kind of hard to remember who all. Yeah.
Someone else.
Yeah.
Somebody was doing. Are you sure you weren't? Because somebody was doing money. I wasn't doing the money. God.
I think Lisa was doing the money for the first couple of years.
No, she only did. Lisa really was only.
She had the bank account wasn't her name on the left.
Yeah, maybe nobody was doing the money in the second year. That could be possible.
That sounds about right.
Yeah. And it was a lot of like getting Jay's philosophy on it and then actioning it, making it happen.
We should talk about the philosophy.
Yeah.
Just a tiny footnote, and you toot your own horn when you do. The first year I set up the Flickr group, then Chris Brogan said, "That's great, but all you people are posting the images under your copyright." So then we put a request. If you're uploading to the Flickr group, please make all your photos CCA, Creative Commons Attribution.
Okay.
So I did that, and then everyone who had contributed a photograph, I just made them co-administrators of the Flickr account, and I left it.
Okay.
And it just is what it is.
Yeah.
So that was that first little interaction that I had with Chris Brogan, and it was like, that's right, here we're talking this stuff, and we're still trying to keep copyright right.
Yeah.
But see, that's a great story, because I don't really think I remember Brogan's email, but I wouldn't have remembered if you set it up.
Yeah.
But now you said that, I'm like, oh yeah. But that's how a lot of this stuff happened early on. Is people just picked up and did stuff. You guys just started doing the blog, and I had honestly forgotten that too. But you didn't have to ask. You just did. You didn't have to ask to set up a Flickr group. You just did it. And I think that was the early. That was if there's a philosophy, if there's anything behind it. I mean, to me, that's it. Is people just picked up and did. Stuff.
And that was the whole thing behind PodCamp at the time too, right? Yeah. Like, remember Boston, like, we're all in this, like, where they shot Goodwill Hunting. We're all in this auditorium, and Brogan and Penn are, you know, explaining what PodCamp is. This is the very first PodCamp, and they're in the opening session. And one thing they did was say, we just happened to get all the rooms. And it sounds cliche, you know, this is your event, and then, but he says, if you're walking somewhere and you see a piece of paper on the floor or a bottle, pick it up and put it in the garbage.
Yeah.
And you know, like, so that instilled, I think, early on, that sense of, well, everybody's part of this and do that. And we saw that in Montreal, the same kind of approach too. And and I think that's faded over the years. There's more of an organizer versus attendee. But I don't know.
I should just mention too, like, even we were just talking about. And
we call them and they appear. We should just name names and see people walk in. Mitch Joel.
That happened at our session where you were talking about you and then.
We did that. Actually, PodCamp, I can't remember which year it was, maybe year four. We had 1,200 people here and we gave that talk at the beginning. It was hard because we couldn't fit everyone in the same space, but we actually had a little write-up first, a blog post, and I think we might have emailed it out to everybody, And then we also verbally said it, and we gave that speech, little speechifying was just, this is your event, it is what you make it, and you also have to help us take care of the space.
Yeah.
And it was like, I don't think we had any cups sitting around, and I mean, might have had a few, but it was amazing.
Yeah.
And people pitched in and helped clean up the chairs, and I mean, we might have had to encourage the odd person, but it was, you would think 1,200 people, that they would have just come and gone and not cared, and my perception was that it was actually went that way. So, yeah, even though it's something that shouldn't scale, theoretically, we somehow did, and I, yeah.
Well, and actually, just to step a little back to year three, my frustration in basically, and actually Connie was saying this last night, it's basically like, you know, the concern leading up to that is Jay going to hold his shit together, you know, for the first day, or is he just going to lose it and start smacking people around? I seriously considered not coming on the Saturday. The reason was because I felt like in the kind of back channel and Twitter whatever world, people were like bitching about stuff that hadn't happened yet, and they were like, the rooms are going to be too full, and this is going to be too that, and blah blah blah. And that was why I was angry. And I was angry because I'm like, people, just come and deal with it. And actually, Rob and I were talking about this, and I was going back to some of the old emails, and Rob sent a message out, and it had a calming effect on me, which was to say, guys, let's just chill out. Let's just see what happens. And I basically said, yeah, that's what we should do. And it did work out. People did.
And I did chill out.
Yeah, this is me chilled out, by the way. But we did that in year three as well, where I stood up on the stairs and I gave that sort of speech to just say, you know, bathrooms are over there. You know, garbage is on the ground, please pick it up. If you don't like a session, log 2 feet, and have a good time, and enjoy yourself. And if you're not enjoying yourself, go home. Because that is the other thing, right? The log 2 feet doesn't just apply to sessions, it applies to the whole thing. If you're here, and you're not, you know, you're not getting it, you know, yeah, like, come on. And I would rather see, this is where PodCamp started to get weird for me, was that it started to seem to be about the numbers of people, and I'm like, you know, and in Boston too, they kind of did this, where they said everybody sign up and everybody come, and a lot of people didn't come, and everybody seemed to be upset that they didn't get 1,000 people there. They only had 350 or 400, and I'm like, that sounds like a good number to me. Like, I don't know why you need 1,000 people. Like, who cares?
In the third year, they actually charged $20.
And then they started charging money, right? And that actually kind of peed me off a little bit, because that was part of the philosophy that I liked, was the free idea, was show up. And you pay with your participation. You know, we're not hiring staff to move chairs. You're moving the chairs. We're not hiring speakers. You're the speakers. I like that.
The only reason they did that was so that people who signed up felt more committed, and they gave them a T-shirt and stuff like that. But yeah.
But my thing has always been, but who gives a crap?
Yes.
Who gives a crap if 10,000 people show up and 10,000 people sign up?
But you know what? What happens is that. Like, you guys here, what you have in Toronto, and first of all, this place, right? I mean, forget it. You're not going to find a better locale to do a podcast event. But other places, like, you know, like Boston, had to rent.
Yeah.
University of Montreal, we had to rent the facilities there. And so what you do is you start laying out cash.
Yeah.
Once you start laying out cash, you need more sponsors.
Yeah.
What do sponsors want? Sponsors want numbers. And that was the creep in of measurement into PodCamp, right?
Yeah.
Remember the what we call the dark years, like, you know, 2009, 2013, where it was just about marketing?
Yes.
Well, you know, it was that.
Those years I didn't really come.
Well, but you know, like, that's how measurement crept in.
Yes, I get it.
Yeah,
I would say those are the years where, like, there's a mood shift where people aren't just picking up chairs. Like, we have to get more volunteers dedicated to do these things that people just did really on their own.
Yeah.
Well, we should shift to kind of, you know, what I think of as sort of the John years, which is when sort of going from me being involved, and really there was actually no crossover in us being organizers together. So you were, I think, like, there was sort of my time, and there was sort of John's time, and then Connie was the bridge between it. That's sort of how I feel about it.
Yeah, well, it was very collaborative. It was Connie, Eden, and Rob, the three of us together.
Yeah, yeah.
Tried to fill Jay's shoes, essentially.
How hard could that have been?
But, you know what we wanted to fill them with?
That's the real question. Rice, cheese, anything, right?
Also, during those years, there were a lot of other conferences and unconferences right across the board throughout the year.
Yes.
And it's something like that culture.
Yeah.
Those other people came in, and it's like this, so like the benchmarks, suddenly standards, and it sort of lost PodCamp, and it just became the unconference on that weekend in February.
Oh, yeah.
Well, yeah, and Social Media Week was during a few years, they had the same weekend as this, so like,
so just
it's all marketing horseshit.
And there was
that just filtered those people out at this event, though, so that was nice.
Guys,
not really.
Yeah.
I mean,
I think you have to remember before, and I'm not a marketer, although I get labeled the marketer before. I think you have to realize what's Mitch Jewell, what's Chris Penn doing now, what's Brogan. These people, the people who started this, they're all in that business. So don't diss the market, don't diss anybody. We're all part of PodCamp. They're also early adopter podcasters and social media, YouTube. So.
But I'll say this as being a marketer,
is that it
shouldn't. There's a place absolutely for it, and the people who are interested in a lot of the early adopters, a lot of people who have been innovators in this space and have been leaders in this space are absolutely marketers, but it shouldn't be about marketing to each other in this environment.
I think that's where it falls down. It became a sales pitch.
That's where it falls down.
A lot of them were people just selling their
books or
their
like
book or
their
website
services,
or their app, and it was like
they
don't come here for you to shield me, I'm here to learn.
Like, I can't speak from after.
Yeah.
But we were, as much as there were a lot of sponsors or whatever, it was very, very, very clear to them whether they followed or not, I can't speak to. They weren't allowed to do that in order to be part of it as a sponsor. And people came to us and said, this is what we want to do. You spent, like, push back with
yeah.
not
yeah.
that.
And to be fair, like, if somebody came and did a session and you thought, oh, this sounds really good, and you get in the room and they're just pitching something to you. I mean, that's where the law of two people
right,
come in. And basically, everybody should get up and leave.
Right.
If that's the case, right? And leave them without an audience. Like, that's, you know, if people are offended. If you want to hear the pitch, then that's great. You know, all the more power to you. But that's sort of where that control is. Now, it's the challenge is empowering people to feel like you can. We're such polite Canadians. Like,
that's what I was
like,
going to say. That.
Have to be stuck in a room, you know. Or there's been situations where the room has been packed with people. And you're the person way at the back, and to get out.
You can't get out.
Yeah, so that you know, in practical terms, it doesn't always work. But that's the theory: is that people can get out.
We need to go all William Shatner Canadian, just dramatically leave.
We should all be doing that. Absolutely.
I'm using the law.
Now on, yes.
This is my first PodCamp.
Okay.
I'm from Niagara, but. The one thing that struck me when I got here was it felt very similar to the Drupal camps that
sure.
I went to all over the place, and they've had similar challenges as they're growing up, and so. But there's been two sort of things that have happened. So some of the events have started to scale up, and you do see some of these things where it becomes more polished. It becomes a little more marketing focused. Again, it's larger. You need more resources in order to make it happen. But then the other part is a horizontal scaling, where we had a bunch of us in Niagara go to the Toronto Drupal Camp. We love it, and we're like, oh, we can do that here. So we get together with the Western New York guys, and we put together an event. We also start doing our own meetups locally, and it grows from there. So, coming here, I'm like, oh my God, we can do an event, and we've got one in the works now, so I'll share something I like later. But the point is, I think that you can have that. I think it's okay that some of these events start to vertically scale, as long as you're encouraging that horizontal scaling as well.
And for sure, we've seen that. So,
did
you want to go say?
Yeah, I mean, let's date ourselves and go back 10, 12 years when there was PodCamp Ottawa, PodCamp Montreal.
Montreal, PodCamp Niagara, PodCamp London.
I really feel like I feel like in 2008 there was almost a PodCamp every weekend.
Yeah.
I really feel that, and I think, and I actually, I would be curious now to go back and look at the wiki. You could probably figure it out, but I really feel like there were 50 PodCamps in 2008.
Yeah. I think there was one in Hamilton.
Coming around again,
Ottawa, Copenhagen. I mean, they were all over, right?
Yeah, so, this was an international movement.
So do we know? Do we know? Like, those don't seem to have continued.
Halifax is the only one that, in Canada that I know
Canada?
Of that still continues.
Yeah.
There's
yeah,
a couple in the United States. There's
yeah.
a lot in developing countries now, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's another PodCamp happening this weekend in a country I can't read the language, so I don't know where they are. That is showing up in our feeds as well now.
There is a wiki that's supposed, everybody's supposed to post their events when they're happening. Now, they call it a diet. I've been one of the people who keeps it up to date sometimes if I think about it.
But have you tried to edit it lately?
No.
You can't edit it.
Really?
You can't get an account. I requested a couple times to get an account. I don't know who's maintaining that.
Oh, okay.
But first off, yes, ma'am.
I have
taken. Yeah.
I feed you, remember?
Yeah, I know. Go ahead.
I attend a WordCamp Toronto that was Andy McIvan that spoke, is one of the co-organizers. A lot of the WordPress, WordCamp conferences, the speakers, it's all about them instead of a topic, you know,
yeah,
there's a difference. Oh, look at me, get my services, blah, 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 instead of talking about the topic.
Mm-hmm.
Notice, unless I'm very selective of the sessions, they're actually about the topic they're talking, not about them selling their book, they're selling their service. I don't have a book, I'm too lazy if anybody wants to write a book for me. But this is what I like about PodCamp in Toronto. It's more about the topics of somebody selling their book, selling their the service. I know where to get web hosting, I know where to get e-books, I know where to get all the stuff, but the topics, you know, if it's a marketing, somebody in WordPress,
yeah,
they're going to sell their marketing book.
And we try and make it very clear to people who want to present and people who we approach to present, like, this is not a sales pitch. If you start getting a sales pitch, people will not be happy with you and they will leave the room. Like, we try and make it very clear, do not be pitching.
Yeah.
There's a
difference. And the audience should know that they should leave the room.
Yeah.
That's the other part of that equation, right?
Yeah.
There is a difference between them say, oh, my .com website, this is my social media, whatever,
yeah,
but
a big difference,
not, this is my book.com, marketingbook.com, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can I share a little anecdote?
Yeah, please.
Okay, so on the way here, I was on the subway listening to a new podcast by BetaKit, which is a Canadian taxi. I got 10 minutes in. And the interesting thing is they were talking about an article, a blog post that was written by a woman from Ottawa named Erin Belasky, and Erin Gurry was quoting her about saying, you know, Twitter's new, you'll see where I'm coming back to podcast, but when Twitter's new algorithm being predominant as opposed to Twitter, how we see it in the order that we want to see, and Twitter trying to shove this stuff, it's not Twitter's problem, it's our problem, because the way the early adopters used to use Twitter was for conversation and talking about, you know, interesting things and sharing, and now it's all self-promotion. Interestingly enough, I think most of us in this room who have been around for a while learned about Twitter at this very place,
mm-hmm,
I think in this very room, at the first PodCamp Toronto. So when you talk about the differences between PodCamp and other events, and then I heard this new podcast that I think is 3 episodes in, that's just a very interesting analogy that ties back.
Did you feel old when you heard those early Twitter adopters, those ancient?
Those early Twitter adopters being this really special group of digital experimenters.
Oh yeah, we were special. but that's and you know what? Like, you can't go home again, right? I mean, and actually, so this is not to pitch my app, but I mean, part of the reason that I wanted to come here and be a sponsor as well is because. Partly it was remembering the old days when anybody would try anything, and it's been a little I'm not bitching about it, but I'm saying it's been a little more tough this year, and I get it. You know, people come up to me and they're like, well, my phone, like, literally my phone is full of apps, I don't have room for yours, and we, you know, like, those weren't the kind of problems that we had 10 years ago, right? Like, everybody was like looking for the thing, or would at
the
least give the new thing, and we tried a lot of crazy crap. Like, we were listing off yesterday, you know, there was Jaiku and Plurk and Pounce and Utters. I used to utter I utter all the time. And you guys, at half of you are going, what the crap is he talking about? Uvu? Oh yeah, Uvu.
Utter's cow.
Yeah, the little cow. Utter's, and then they changed it to Utterly.
Yeah.
And then they just disappeared. And I mean, but that was the world, right? It was just like, and who knew, and Twitter was just another thing. And who knew it was going to be what it was? And you know, so, and now I feel like people are probably a little more jaded about it, and rightly so in a way, because there's a trillion zillion apps, and I mean, I'm selling an app too, so.
There's that Elo thing that came out last year, and I remember for 24 hours I was excited about it, signed up, and made a couple posts, and I have not touched it ever since.
No, like, Peach, like 2 weeks ago.
Yeah. Thought I had heard of that.
Yeah, Peach is like the same sort of thing as Elo. It's like,
we're trying to figure out what the hell we do with Peach. I don't know.
It's dead now.
But that's the thing, right? You give it a week. And you don't figure it out. It's like, well, you move on to the next thing because there's a million other things, right?
Yeah.
And before, like, I had a Twitter account for ages before I really figured out what to do with it, and it was kind of going to camps and seeing things, and then South By came, and that kind of took off. And I was like, okay, this is what it's about. But I think I had two tweets in the first 3 months that I had my Twitter account because I didn't know what it was about. And then I started to see it, but I sat on it and I kept kind of coming back to it and saying, well, what the hell's going on with this? Wouldn't do that now. If I haven't looked at an app in my phone for 10 minutes, I'd probably delete it.
Well, if
there's
not a community there to converse with you, that's what's happening. Peach has some really cool features, but it's a ghost town.
Yeah. I want to bring that more directed PodCamp and to kind of now, and actually John and I started talking yesterday, and I think this is, and this, I want to connect this with Bob's point about, so part of, I think, why we've been blessed in Toronto is because part of this building, definitely the community, definitely John and the people who have taken it on after the rest of us have gone. So, you know, full credit to John and Rick and Lily and the folks who are still running the SAM. And that's a huge part of the reason that this is still in Toronto and it's not in a lot of other places. So that's, you know, full on credit to you guys for that. But the other thing we should talk about is, so how do we go forward from here? Because now the challenge, and you know, we just started talking about this, right? So I know you guys lost Rogers as a sponsor, who were
They laid off their entire social media team, so there was no one to even talk to.
They were
and,
they did their job.
Well,
they were repositioned.
Oh, right. But the focus is changing in corporate around that stuff, and that's not that. Again, we're not going back to that world where people have social media teams, right? And you know what? Kind of rightly so. Like, let's be honest, right? Social media shouldn't be a thing off in a room. It should be part of the larger practice. So what you're not going to see, I think, is social media teams who are going to come to social media events and talk about social media with social media people. Well, those days are over, I think.
Thank God.
Right? So what is the next thing, right? And how do we move forward to this? So
yeah, so like a big issue is funding, for sure.
Yeah.
Wow.
I think that was our biggest year for a team, right? Or maybe 2011.
12, 11?
No, 10 was the biggest year.
Holy crap!
Wow. That's great. Wow.
14.
Look at all these people. I remember some of these people. Oh. Is that, are we,
No.
did we say it?
I like your background.
Did we say the password? Win something?
So the biggest thing is funding it. Like, we have space, we have people coming out, we have people submitting sessions.
Yeah.
Sort of figured out how the whole session thing works now. Because one of the things we did when we first took over was like, okay, there's going to be, you know, we have this many rooms, we're all going to dedicate X amount of space for each category so that there's like an even content. And now the challenge is, you know, funding. Like, it's like 20K that we sort of need.
Yeah.
So
to
get this run, we made 8K this year.
So I would say you go back to the basic principles.
Yeah.
You know, you spend what you have. If you don't get the funding, then you just scale it back to whatever. Like, you know, pub night becomes
you pay for your own
food, right? You book the space or whatever.
About that.
I know it's a challenge. you know, you also see the numbers come and go. You have fewer people. You could probably run fewer sessions as well than the rooms are fuller. I mean, your philosophy was always you'd rather have the room a little too small and have people packed into the room than to have empty rooms.
Yeah, absolutely.
it increases the enthusiasm, and
we got a lot of feedback about the rooms being too full at certain points, so we started trying to
accommodate,
and now they're getting too empty now, so it's time to retract.
But I think the numbers, like, I run a conference for a professional association I've been involved in, and we'd be happy with these numbers of people, 300, you know, however many, 350 people or however many are here. Like, we would be delighted to have this many. And so I don't think that it's that you have too few people. One of the principles is one of the principles is whoever shows up are the right people.
Yeah.
So as long as there are people showing up, I think that's great. And you just, you know, you can add on the luxury items, you know, so-called luxury items. Well, the things that you need when you do have big crowds, you maybe don't need as much stuff when you have fewer people showing up.
Yeah, and that's the only reason we scaled up, is because we had the money and we had to do something with it.
Well, we had to accommodate the larger groups of people.
We had to, but we also had money, so we were like, oh, let's make
they went hand in hand. Yeah.
Also, there's a lot of tools, you know, out there for you know, podcasters that, you know, they're not represented, you know, in the sponsors list. And I know how much time goes into contacting them, so it's not a criticism.
We do contact tons of people, like probably 100 people every year. Mm-hmm. They do not care.
Everybody's going.
An event of 1,000 people means nothing to a corporation or a small company, and it's a free event, so also they don't like that because it doesn't qualify people as having money.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I've heard that a couple times this year. Like, it's free, so we don't know that these
and
people have
attendance,
money.
And it means your attendance numbers are looser.
Yeah.
Because if you know 1,000 people register for a paid event, probably 800, 900 people are going to show up. If you know 1,000 people register for a free event, you're lucky if you get 500. And that's across the board. I do a lot of events now with what I'm doing, and that's how it is. So we always say, oh, yeah, it's free, but we don't do that.
Yeah.
So
that was sort of my next point, is that if, you know, whoever pays basically gets to, you know, they at least get a say in the conversation of how things are structured. So why aren't participants paying?
Well, I think there's two things there. One is that they do get a say, but they don't get to sell. And that is different than some, like, if you pay enough at a conference, you can do a sales pitch, essentially, at, like, a lot of conferences, right?
Yeah.
Or do at least a sponsored room, or do a something that's more salesy. And here, you can't and probably shouldn't do that, or if you do, you're going to get
Same with the Drupal campus.
Right? And that's part of it. But I do think the other part of it is this numbers game that is, I'm not trying to whine or anything, but, I mean, I got numbers I got to meet for a quarter right now. And, you know, coming to PodCamp, I was hoping I'd get a few more numbers, like, I'm not going to cry about it, but it's if I had done this sort of without all the rest of the relationship and stuff that I'd have here, I'd be a little pissed off at the numbers that I've got this weekend, because not as many people are stepping up to not only care, because it's, you know, PodCamp, I love you guys, but that is if they don't already love us, then that's going to be a thing. I wanted to actually say something about the whole thing of extras and that. And I think, Grant, you were telling me a story at some PodCamp, somebody got up and said, I just came for a free t-shirt or something.
Oh, yeah, last year at the wrap-up, there was a guy complaining about lack of t-shirts.
And I want to say publicly, fuck that guy. That guy is not the guy that should be at PodCamp. No, I mean, really.
Yeah,
last night
at the bar, we were sitting right by a bunch of people, and they were like, oh, there's not enough food. I'm not going to come tomorrow if they don't give us enough food. And it's like, fuck you, get out.
But see, that's
the first
and that's,
serving.
Yeah.
It's like this.
Like right at 6 o'clock.
Yeah.
Of course,
like, get out
right
there.
Although there was one little thing, which is you couldn't order other food there.
So
if you were hungry, I kind of get that, because I actually did go out and get a sandwich.
But that's the lottery. You got on your own TV.
That's right, exactly. That's right, exactly. Yes,
but that's the way to tell those people to fuck off before they piss you off. That's the key, right? Like, before they angry. Like, a filter is,
yes,
you know,
you're right.
But that's, and that's the, so, again, first year at PodCamp, you know, I've known about it for, like, the last 3 years, you know, couldn't make it, finally got a chance to make it this year, blown away by it. But one of the things that I was most blown away about is how generous this is, right? Absolutely free, you know, then free drinks, free food, it's, you know, also the night at the Imperial Pub, oh my God, that was awesome. Mm-hmm. But it's, you guys are giving away too much.
So here's the thing, and this is actually, I was hoping Jay would talk about it, because it came back to what we always went by, was the moment you charge, and even if you charge $10 for nominal fee, people start to expect stuff.
and whatever you give them is not going to be enough. So, you know, we're not feeding you. Yeah. We're not giving you a T-shirt.
Yeah,
so,
they're saying that while it's free, though. So imagine if they're paying for it.
Yeah.
Like, they're going to
raise their goals. So that's sort of always what I went. I also run a meetup group, and we started off having it free, and it was the same sort of thing. We never, people would sign up, and then hardly anyone would show up. So we put in place $10 of meetup, and now we know the people who pay for it pretty much are going to show up. And so there is that philosophy, but we got to know, like, there is a certain attrition rate. You get so many people, you know, if you have 800 people sign up, you figure you're going to get probably 500 show up, I guess. Mm-hmm. And we got to know that. So it wasn't so much that we needed those numbers, but it was that expectation setting.
Miroslav, and then Eden, but I want to just call Bill in London. They charged $2. And it was, we were talking about this, and it was like $2 is nothing to, like, everybody can afford $2. But the whole thing was, and you even did a freebie code.
I put it in PodCamp.
That was awesome.
It was a coupon code to be free. So, like, anybody who's like, because we had a bunch of people complain they don't have a credit card.
Right.
Just use this coupon code, and you don't need a credit card anymore. It's free. And a bunch of people guessed the coupon code. But the thing is, like, somebody who's going to guess the coupon code, somebody's going to spend the time trying to guess the coupon code,
probably.
Is actually going to show up.
Probably show up.
And again, I had a lot of people complaining because we did it for 2 years and then charge the third year because we were having that problem. We were holding the event at a place where there wasn't food within, like it was a 10-minute drive for food,
yeah,
so
yeah,
we had to provide
kind
food. And we had sponsors that were going to do that, but we really needed to have a pretty close idea of how many people were going to show up.
Yeah.
Because food was an issue. So that's where the third year we went. I said, like, the first year was downtown, so that wasn't a problem. But the third year was where, like, also you kind of get popular enough where people know you and you get a lot of people coming.
Yeah.
So,
I
had a lot of people pissed off that we're charging now, like all of a sudden you're charging. I said, for starters, like, use this coupon code. And people were, like, accusing me of trying to profit from it. I'm like, do you understand? I don't know how many people have done online transactions, but do you know what you get out of $2?
Yeah.
Like, literally 30 cents. It costs a $2 transaction. Like, it really wasn't making money. Like, we weren't able to buy coffee in the morning with the money we made off the registration.
It wasn't for that.
So it really was just that kind of really low barrier,
right,
worked perfectly. Yeah. And nobody complained.
Yeah,
I actually walked around most of the day with a pocket full of toonies, so if anybody complained, I should hand them money. That's my attitude to you.
You're talking waiting patiently.
Yeah.
The average WordCamp event is $35. You get a shirt, you get lunch. In average,
sure.
WordCamp Toronto, 1 year, they had no T-shirts. Twitter turned into a bitch fest, pardon my language. Like, oh my, I refused, that was the only thing I didn't attend because people would bitch, no T-shirt. I have 1,000 T-shirts of conferences because that's the ones I attend, but a lot of these technology conferences are $1,000, $800. All the business conferences, even $35, it's nothing. You're getting free, getting the coffee, when the organizers here come at way earlier, 6, 7, 8, whatever. In WordCamp Toronto, I am there at 7 in the morning. I'm volunteering my time. There's still no coffee until about 10 in the morning, so 3 hours. The advantage of WordCamp in the Humber College lecture campus, there's Tim Hortons right across the building that's open 24 hours for the students. You know, but there are a lot of conferences who charge you $1,000 and still don't give you things, and people still complain, no matter what you give them. There's still something that's going to turn into a bitch fest,
you know? I think the answer, though. I think you cannot please everyone.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, absolutely.
That's amazing.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I have a really weird thing, and I didn't sleep last night, so forgive me, but I'm just trying to think of something that might help to sustain the podcast, because even if it's free, there's still operating costs.
Yeah.
And it seems like the day of big sponsorship dollars or even medium sponsorship dollars, they were never huge, but they were big for PodCamp, are gone. And the vault, our dollar, you know, the world is different today.
Yeah, there's no ROI on sponsoring PodCamp.
Yeah.
There's kind of two types of people who would like these kind of things from a presenter type of thing, and I'm just trying to think of the world that's out there. There are a lot of people now putting on paid workshops, right? And a lot of them don't necessarily have the infrastructure to attract an audience or to get space easily without overhead, and they would love access to this audience.
Mm-hmm.
So what if
that's
you ran a sort of like a parallel event where at the same time as PodCamp Toronto, it's kind of these PodCamp Toronto workshops where the workshop organizers are paying to have a spot, people pay to attend their workshops, but there's a series of free events that are the regular PodCamp events.
Yeah, yeah.
That was something we talked about this year, actually.
Yeah, yeah.
The people who want to sell can sell, and it helps offset the cost.
Did we talk about that with Mitch in, like, 2008? I feel like we had that conversation.
I don't remember.
I feel like we had that conversation, you, me, and Mitch. That exact conversation.
This is happening with Drupal. So the Drupal cons, like, the day before the conference.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's a workshop track.
Yeah, we talked about that pretty extensively this year, about doing something separate for just, like, a sponsor stream. Because we're not allowed to have paid, like, everyone is supposed to be equal, so how are we going to put, like, a guaranteed session for a presenter in a room? Yeah. Well, if it was a separate event, then how do we do that? Because we had a lot of requests for sponsors to be speakers.
Right.
If they would give it, on the condition they were giving money. So.
What if we made it clear and we had a sponsor session track?
Yeah, so that's what we talked about doing. The challenge then becomes, like, how do you message that as being not part of PodCamp,
right,
but part of PodCamp.
Yeah.
Well, they did it. Social Capital in Ottawa used to do it. They tried it. I was there 3 years ago, and they had before Social Capital, the day before, they had a day of workshops. And so it was positioned differently.
Yeah.
You did pay separately to attend the workshops. You picked, you either could pay a flat rate and go to X number, or you paid per workshop.
Yeah.
So it's something that you might want to think about if we're going to help generate the revenue. You're going to have those people who want to sell.